to know more such amazing stories from Indian history, click the bell icon and subscribe to Live History India.
This hill fort in Daulatabad, close to Aurangabad in Maharashtra, looms large over an otherwise flat stretch and stands out as one of the most important forts in the history of medieval India. First built by the Yadavas when they moved their capital here and known as Deogiri or Devgiri since then, so famed was this town and fort for its wealth that it attracted the sultans of the north. Starting the 13th century, it became a stepping stone for anyone wanting to make their way into the Deccan and the south of Peninsula India. It was here that Alauddin Khilji came before claiming the throne of Delhi. It was here where his fierce general Malik Kafur camped as he raided the Deccan. It was here that Muhammad bin Tughlaq shifted his capital in 1328 and named it Daulatabad. It was here where the Bahamani Empire was born, where the famous African slave turned General Malik Amber reigned from, where Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb lived, and where the first Nizam of Hyderabad declared his independence. Historian Pushkar Soni, who has done a considerable amount of work on the medieval history of the Deccan, takes us through the story of Daulatabad and why it was so significant.
Anybody who has control over Daulatabad controls a large swath of the central Deccan. And it is because of this that several people thought it was advantageous to control Daulatabad as a gateway to conquering other kingdoms in the Deccan. Very famously, the Khiljis and then the Tughlaqs try to use Daulatabad in this way. Daulatabad also becomes an important place when it is founded as the capital city of the Yadava kingdom. It is known by the name of Devgiri, and from here through the 13th century, they carry out raids on the Chalukyas of Gujarat, the Hoysalas in the south, the Kakatiyas in the east, and the Parmaras of Malwa. And they manage to amass a lot of fortunes in this place, Devgiri. And the fame of this treasure reaches Delhi, which becomes one more reason for why Daulatabad becomes so central in the history of India. Not only is it strategically important, both in military and mercantile terms, but it also has become this place of fabled wealth that attracts everyone. Daulatabad becomes very important for the Delhi Sultanate in the 13th century because Alauddin Khilji, while he's not yet the Sultan of Delhi, decides that the only way he can get the throne of Delhi is by amassing a lot of wealth, which he does from raiding Daulatabad, which of course at that time is called Devgiri. It is this fabled wealth of Devgiri that allows him to usurp the throne of Delhi. And so it plays a very important role in his coming to power. Of course, when he attacks in 1296, Devgiri is taken by surprise. They've never expected a raid from the north quite in this way. They submit to his rule and agree to pay him tribute every year. He goes back, eventually gains power in Delhi. But the Yadava kings stop paying tribute and stop being vassals of the Delhi sultans. And so in 1307 and then later again, a general called Malik Kafur is sent down to Daulatabad to subdue the Yadavas, and he finally completely vanquishes the kingdom in 1313 or so. Now, a later successor of the Delhi Sultanate, Muhammad bin Tughlaq, also while making inroads into various kingdoms of the Deccan, such as the Kakatiyas and then Madurai down south, decides that Daulatabad would be an ideal place from where to control his sprawling empire, because it sits more or less in the middle of his big kingdom. And so he decides to march in 1328 most of the population of Delhi down to Daulatabad, where after a period of 6-7 years in 1335, he asks them to move back again. And the reason for that is there are all kinds of rebellions taking place in the north, which he cannot control. from being in Daulatabad. But Daulat, which literally also means government in Persian, this is the seat of government, and which is why the name Daulatabad is very apt for it. It's not wealth or treasure, it's really the seat of government. When Muhammad bin Tughlaq decided in 1335 to move his capital back to Delhi from Daulatabad, some of his court were left behind as administrators, but some also of their own volition, because they didn't want to make this journey back under this mad sultan. There was also a large faction of what were called Dakhani Muslims who stayed back because this was the region to which they belonged. And these people decided to cause a rebellion in 1347. So 1335 is when Muhammad Tughlaq moves capital to Delhi. A number of small provinces of his large empire start declaring rebellion and independence. And you have in 1337, two brothers, Harihar and Bukka, who have been in his service, declare independence as the kingdom of Vijayanagar. 10 years later, the Bahmani kingdom will be founded. Of course, it's with a little wrinkle, because it's somebody called Nasir Ismail Mukh who is elected as the chief of these rebels. And he rules from Daulatabad, from where they declare rebellion, for 2 years. And after 2 years, he abdicates in favor of Hasan Gangu Bahman Shah, earlier called Zafar Khan. And this would be the foundation of the Bahmani dynasty. Remember, Daulatabad is important enough that it serves as the capital of multiple dynasties. You have the Delhi Sultanate. Before that, you have the Yadavs. You have the Bahmanis declaring independence from here. One of the Bahmani successors, the Nizam Shahs, use this as their secondary capital. And it is from the twin settlement of Daulatabad, the city of Khadki or Aurangabad, that the Asaf Jahs, that is the Nizams of Hyderabad, will also declare independence. So the central role of this region around Daulatabad cannot be denied. All trade passes through here, all major political ferment happens here, and all kinds of military marches really start from here.
The fort of Daulatabad was used as a launch pad for many an ambitious king in the medieval world, but few retained this as a capital. The stretch south was just too vast to be managed from here. The Bahmani shifted their capital to Gulbarga, 430 kilometers south, in 1347, before moving on to Bidar. And the later Nizam Shahs also preferred to house their capital in Ahmednagar, en route to Daulatabad from Junnar, where they started out from. Daulatabad, however, remained an important center through the centuries, also becoming the Mughal garrison in the Deccan later.
The rebellion against Muhammad bin Tughlaq at Daulatabad leads to the founding of the Bahmani dynasty. They rule from here very shortly, but then they decide to move their capital down south to Gulbarga. One of the big reasons is that they are rivals with the kingdom of Vijayanagara, which is further to the south, and they really need to be close to the frontier against Vijayanagara. Now, it is the Raichur Doab, which is a very fertile tract of land that both these kingdoms, the Bahmanis and Vijayanagar, are trying to control. And though the Bahmanis will move south and move their ceremonial capital away, Daulatabad remains very important throughout their reign. In fact, it becomes the capital city of one of their provinces or Tarafs. And so this northern province, which is very important because it's the frontier against all kinds of kingdoms to the north, whether you have Gujarat or Malwa and so on, really has to be governed by important officials. And through the 15th century, we see the Bahmanis taking special care of Daulatabad. So though it doesn't serve as a capital, it serves as a provincial capital. And it still doesn't lose its importance because it's not the seat of political power. It retains a certain kind of importance despite not being the seat of royalty. The Nizam Shahs are the ones who have their eyes on the coveted fort of Daulatabad. And it's towards this goal that though they've declared independence at the town and fort of Junnar, every year they try to mount a campaign to capture Daulatabad. And it is in the course of these recurring annual campaigns that the city of Ahmednagar, which goes on to become their capital city, is actually founded. And Ahmednagar is founded because it is a location from where campaigns against Daulatabad are easily possible. Of course, by 1499, Daulatabad is firmly in the hands of the Nizam Shahs, and they don't need to use Ahmednagar as a base for campaigning against it. But Daulatabad is such a prestige city that it almost becomes their de facto capital anytime Ahmednagar is under raid. Now, Daulatabad is supremely defensible. It's a hill with a scarp that's in the middle of a big plain. Ahmednagar, by comparison, is a city that's a lot more open to military attack. And so every time the city of Ahmednagar is under any kind of duress, the Nizam Shahs will flee to either Junnar or Daulatabad, because Ahmednagar is right in the middle of both these important forts. But more often than not, we see them retreating to Daulatabad. Daulatabad also has the added advantage of not just being militarily important. It is one of the most important sacred centers, while not Daulatabad itself. 3 kilometers from it is the town of Khuldabad, once upon a time known as Rauza. And so in many ways, if control of Daulatabad was necessary for military control over the Deccan, control over Khuldabad was necessary for spiritual control over the Deccan. And so many people who use Daulatabad as a capital use it as a secondary capital, as a refuge, think it is more secure because it has a spiritual mantle, a protection offered by nearby Khuldabad. In the late 16th century, there are all kinds of troubles in the Nizam Shahi kingdom. And the person who comes to power is the regent, Malik Amber, a slave brought from Africa, a Habshi, who eventually will completely take the reins of power by 1600. The city of Ahmednagar, the fort of Ahmednagar, fall to the Mughals around 1600. And the royal family, which determines what the capital is, will move from different forts, from Ausa and Paranda and Junnar, finally settling in Daulatabad. And Malik Amber will eventually marry his daughter to the young Nizam Shahi prince. And as the father-in-law of the nominal Nizam Shahi king, become the de facto ruler of the Nizam Shahi kingdom. Now, it's ironic that the dynasty that's called the Nizam Shahs of Ahmednagar will continue, except it's not ruled by any of the Nizam Shahs, and it's actually not based out of Ahmednagar. It would be fitting to call this last phase the rule of Malik Amber of Daulatabad. And he carries out a number of significant improvements in Daulatabad. He enhances the water supply system. He builds a whole new set of walls around Daulatabad, expanding the area under protective control. He makes a number of military improvements. And eventually, as is the trend at the end of the 16th century, he decides to found close by, about 10 to 15 kilometers southeast of the fort of Daulatabad, a new mercantile settlement called Khadki. He builds a number of mosques, puts in a water supply system, lays out certain streets, and builds there what is called the Bhadkal Darwaza, close to his palace. This darwaza is not a city gate, but it's a ceremonial gate, much like the Charminar. And so Daulatabad now remains a military garrison, a treasury, a place where the royal family will live, a place where diplomats will be received. But the civilian population of the settlement of Daulatabad in large number moves to this new city of Khadki. This is the city that will serve as the imperial capital of the Mughals. Though it's not called a capital, it is the capital city because the viceroy of the Deccan, who for many years is Aurangzeb, will live in Aurangabad. And Aurangzeb, when he's back campaigning in the Deccan late in his career, will also live here for another significant number of years. Now, Daulatabad becomes all the more important because Mughal emperors start constructing palaces in Daulatabad. There is a Baradari right on top of the fort, but there is also a magnificent palace with a couple of hammams right at the bottom. And these are all built because the Mughal emperor, whenever he lives in Aurangabad, seems to spend significant amounts of time actually in the fort of Daulatabad. A, because it's secure, and B, it's a lot more pleasant living high up on a hill in Daulatabad than it would be to live in a city.
By the time of the late Nizam Shahs, when the African general Malik Amber thwarted attempts by the Mughal forces to push south, Daulatabad had become too small to house the army barracks and the market town that had grown around the fort. Malik Amber founded the city of Kharki close by, and this soon became an imposing city. However, its glory was short-lived, with the Mughals attacking it in 1621. Subsequently, they took over the region, including Daulatabad and its fort. In 1653, when Prince Aurangzeb was appointed the Viceroy of the Deccan for the second time, he made Fatehnagar close by his capital and called it Aurangabad.
Aurangabad becomes a very successful city, of course not known as Aurangabad till much later, but the city of Kharki is a very successful city because it is planned and planned along with infrastructure. It becomes easy to grow the city in different modules very quickly. Malik Amber also ensures that his country is completely safe. There are a number of accounts where people marvel at the kind of safety you have in the countryside, which ensures that traders pass through, caravans can rest. There's a wonderful caravan sarai at a place called Sarai Nizampur, close to the fort of Daulatabad, where many traders would have halted for the night. There would have been many more such camping grounds around the whole area, serving Aurangabad, serving Daulatabad, serving Khuldabad. And again, because of the spiritual status of Khuldabad, nobody really invades Khuldabad. The battles are all about Daulatabad. Khuldabad just passes very peacefully along with the fort of Daulatabad to whoever controls it. The same holds true for the city of Aurangabad. Whoever has control over Daulatabad has control over Aurangabad. When Aurangzeb is posted as a viceroy of the Deccan, he already has imperial ambitions. And we know this because he commissions a big tomb to the memory of his wife, Rabia Durrani, in Aurangabad, from where he is ruling as the viceroy. The tomb, Bibi Ka Maqbara, is very often credited to his son, but it is almost certain that Aurangzeb himself oversees it. He realizes that an act of being emperor involves putting up very large and impressive buildings, and therefore he hires people from the family of the designers of the Taj to come and work on the Bibi Ka Maqbara. It's just that towards the completion of this mausoleum, he has to rush to Delhi to compete with his brothers for the Mughal throne, and his son will oversee the completion of this building. But his ambition of being Mughal emperor is embodied in Aurangabad from before he was Mughal emperor. Later, he will return and stay in Aurangabad for a long time in a palace called the Qila Arq, which is set on a high ground just north of the city with an impressive access along several gates that leads to the Sarafa or the bazaar. There is a large orchard garden behind this palace to the north of this palace called Himayat Bagh. Aurangzeb carries out a number of improvements. He builds city walls around the city of Aurangabad to protect against raids. He also, again, invites a number of people to come and settle in Aurangabad. And so a lot of Mughal noblemen come and settle in Aurangabad, lending their names to various wards of the city. There is a lovely museum in the Baba Saheb Ambedkar Marathwada University campus, which is the mansion of a nobleman. This is known as the Soneri Mahal. And you can see the expanse, the garden, the estate, or at least imagine a large part of it when you visit. Aurangzeb lived in Aurangabad for the last several years of his reign. He did not directly commission a lot of buildings. The Mughal Empire was probably at its territorial greatest, but he had fought a number of Pyrrhic wars, and his treasury was depleted. He also himself had become a very austere and meager person. A number of noblemen that he settled in Aurangabad built for themselves mansions and estates. But Aurangzeb has very few fingerprints on the city. Aurangzeb dies at his military camp in the town of Bhingar, close to Ahmednagar. And from there, as per his wishes, his body was eventually moved to Khuldabad to be buried in the compound of the shrine of Zainuddin Shirazi. He believed, like a lot of people, that being buried in the company of saints would ensure a good afterlife.
The fort and city of Daulatabad needs to be seen in its geographical context vis-a-vis the city of Aurangabad, around 42 kilometers away, and Khuldabad, about 12 kilometers to the north, which together formed a historic whole. If Daulatabad was a strategic military center, Aurangabad was a populous city near it, and Khuldabad, with the dargahs of a series of Sufi saints, the spiritual hub.
Three settlements of Aurangabad, Daulatabad, and Khuldabad represent possibly the cleanest separation of functions that a single settlement can have. By the end of the 17th century, it's very clear that Aurangabad is the civilian and mercantile settlement, Daulatabad is the military and administrative settlement, and Khuldabad is the spiritual settlement. All three of them require very different levels of protection. Khuldabad does not require military protection. Aurangabad, when it's under attack, will usually negotiate. The merchants of the town will have some kind of settlement. None of the invaders will actually want to destroy the town because it's to their benefit to hold on to it as it is. And Daulatabad will only see military engagement because it is, after all, the military city. So we are really looking at the mercantile city, the military city, and the ecclesiastical city. Aurangabad, during its short occupation by the Marathas, never really becomes a city in the same mold. The next people who will really shape the city are the Nizams of Hyderabad. And they have a real connection with the city of Aurangabad because this is where Kilich Khan, who becomes the first Nizam of Hyderabad, declares independence in the city of Aurangabad. And he has himself throned here, though he never calls himself the king. Right till the end, the Nizams of Hyderabad will carry on with the pretense of being courtiers of the Mughal king. But it is here in 1724 that he declares a kind of provincial independence. And then he will shift his capital to Hyderabad a few years later. But again, this seems to be the area from where kingdoms are born, where rebellions are declared, and where new polities seem to be emerging from. Aurangabad is the provincial headquarters of one of the large divisions of the state of Hyderabad. And so Aurangabad remains a very important administrative town. It produces a number of literary figures in the 18th, 19th, and 20th centuries. The person who is known as Baba-e-Urdu, Abdul Haq, who later moved to Pakistan and founded the Anjuman-e-Tarakki-e-Urdu-e-Pakistan, also operated from Aurangabad. You have people like Wali Dakhani go to the Mughal court in the 18th century and impress everybody with his poetry. He also is from Aurangabad. And Aurangabad, even in the 20th century, has a real legacy of being a city of literature and of high culture. The physical fabric of Aurangabad should actually be a lot richer than it is today. Aurangabad is a very historic city, and it is a shame that we cannot see multiple layers of occupation the way we ought to. Individual buildings survive. You have a few buildings from the reign of Malik Ambar, some from the Mughal period, some from the Maratha occupation, and also a lot of administrative buildings from the period of the Nizams of Hyderabad. But there is no sense of a larger historic fabric for the city. It is disappearing very fast. What you only have are highlights that remain behind. The fabric that keeps it all together is gone. You have gates, you have a few palaces, and you have the stray building that managed to survive. So For example, a palace that Aurangzeb lived in for a long period of time lies in complete ruins. While the palace was converted to an arts college for a while and then abandoned, the grounds around it, which lent it a certain kind of importance, have completely disappeared. The large maidan in front, which would have been partially a garden and partially a tent city for the emperor's troops, is now completely covered by high-rise buildings. The large orchard gardens behind Aurangzeb's palace, the Himayat Bagh, will slowly be parceled off for more modern development. Unless these larger landscapes are preserved, individual monuments make no sense out of context. And therefore, one hopes that in areas around Daulatabad, around Aurangabad, and around Khuldabad, while the emphasis has been on preserving individual buildings alone, larger landscapes in which they are set really need to be maintained. Otherwise, none of these settlements nor the important buildings therein can really be understood in any kind of meaningful way.
The fort of Daulatabad has to be really seen in the larger context of the region it stands in. While most tourists traveling to Aurangabad see the main sites like the Bibi Ka Maqbara, the Sufi shrines, and also the tombs of the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb and his trusted general Asif Jah I, the first Nizam of Hyderabad, few realize just how significant this fort was in the rise of kingdoms that shaped the political landscape of medieval India.